communication. Tonight, we're going to be in the Gospel of John. This will be our 56th exposition of this book. We're going to be in the fourth chapter, verses 51 through 54. John 4, 51 through 54. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, "Thy son liveth." Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend. And they said unto him, "Yesterday at the seventh hour the fever left him." So the father knew that it was at that same hour in the which Jesus said unto them, "Thy son liveth," and himself believed, and his whole house. This is again the second miracle that Jesus did when he was come out of Judea into Galilee. Now, when it comes to the things of God, it's characteristic of the natural man, the person that's not born again, to think small. That's how the old man, you think small. When it comes to the kingdom of God, you think small. This is because God's not at the core of the thinking of unregenerate man. And while a person's in that kind of posture, he thinks of possibilities as confined to the course of nature and human aptitude. Those are the boundaries of possibility, nature and human aptitude. And the natural man can't get beyond that at all. And you know when a person, you know where a person's positioned, you know, on the scale of attitude, you know where a person is by how possible they think things are with God. That tells you kind of where they're at. If they tend to give up easily, their weight, they're down on the nature side. If they complain and gripe a lot, they're down on the nature side. You really got to recognize that. Now this way of thinking small and limiting possibilities to courses of nature, natural causes, and to human aptitude, it's like an affliction that plagues the modern church. Yeah. It's like a disease, a spiritual disease. And it's very difficult to recover from this disease. Yeah. Some people takes years before they're able to kind of make some progress in this area. Now, it isn't because there's lack of information on this from God. Jesus said, "With God, all things are possible." All right, that's a divine utterance. There's no possibility that's not exactly right. And he's apostolic doctrine develops that a little bit more. It's just not that he's there and he can do anything and we're here, then hardly anything can be done. See, it's not like that. In redemption, here's what he tells us. We can know, not intellectually know, not like math table know. You can work with it and realize it, not question it. You can know what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward, to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. What kind of power is it? Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that's named, not only in this world but that which is to come. Well, that's as great a power as there is, and that power is focused not toward angels, toward us. Amen. That's the word. And it's announced that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. See, so that's he spelled out what. But you'll be hard-pressed, I'm telling you the truth. You'll be hard-pressed to find a person that believes that. Believes that, depends on that, asks requests that need that. It's amazing. There's a lot of prayer requests that really you could deliver them to the President of the United States or the town mayor. You know, that it just about anybody could do it. I felt the pull of that myself, but you really got to seek to break loose from that. Completely. You don't want to pray like there isn't any God at all. Now, the Spirit knew the times in which we're living in, and so he makes these statements. Through Paul, he made these statements because men tend to lose sight of this. As centuries roll on, pretty soon people aren't thinking about the power that's in you. That God's able to do all things according to the power that works in, not on us, works in us. As time rolls on, all of a sudden these things, they become vague. And under the incapable leadership of religious professionals, they've managed to almost destroy a consciousness of this. We've got boards and committees and plans and we've got all kind of things that take the place of the power, which means the church is powerless. That's why it's seeking all of these things. As we walk through these inspired records, that's what we're doing. We're like walking through these accounts. You want to be alert, have good spiritual peripheral vision, be able to pick up on the implications of Scripture and this sort of thing. Labor to be able to recall what Jesus actually did. It's in your memory bank. There's sometimes things will arise, there'll be an incident in Scripture about Jesus that precisely matches your circumstance. Something nobody can help, you got to send somebody to Jesus, say, come down and help us. It just precisely matches. But if you're unable to recall, if your memory's been polluted with a lot of other stuff, so that you can just remember like stupid songs you've heard the world sing, news headlines, you know, there's a lot of stuff you can remember. Amen. But it's difficult in our age and our where we live in the world to culture a mindset where you remember what Jesus said and did. Amen. But you can do it. When what is, well, let me make this clear. Jesus is doing more now in heaven than he did when he was on earth. So you think that was something? When Jesus was on earth? That was a beginning. He's doing more now. Amen. In fact, when he's on earth, he says, how I am straightened. That's a straight, like a straight jacket. I'm held in, I'm confined, I'm limited to what I can do. Well, I'm here. Then he said in John 5:20 that he said, you're going to see greater works than these. And he'd like display some mighty works, I'll tell you. Now, while Jesus was here upon earth, his ministry, according to Luke, consisted of what he began to do and teach. What he began to do and teach. When we went back to heaven, he didn't quit doing and teaching. He started it here to kind of acquaint us with the kind of things Jesus does. Jesus will never confront a circumstance he doesn't have a precise and effective answer for. You'll never confront a circumstance with which he can't deal. He demonstrated that in his ministry. He began to do and teach. Now he's continuing. to do and teach. And I want to encourage you to believe that. Work on believing that. We believe in not a historical Jesus. We believe in a living Jesus, a living Christ, not a historical one. Well, our text is after he came to Jesus. He asked him, heal our son. Jesus responded by saying, except you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. And he said, come down and help us. He pressed in, you know, pressed in. So Jesus says, your son's alive. He said, now go. Now go now. So he's on his way back in our text. He's on his way back. After hearing the word of Jesus, Jesus said, go thy way. And he did like Abraham. When God told Abraham, leave Ur of Chaldees, he went. That's what he did. He did as much as God told him to do. Leave Ur of Chaldees. And he told him when to leave Haran, go down to Canaan. Told him when to do it. And when he told him to do it, he did it. All right, this is what this man did. Jesus told him to do something, yeah. He did it.
Amen.
Remember, Abraham believed God when he said that Sarah was going to have the promised son. He didn't know that till he was 99 years old.
Yeah.
He got the promise when he's 70 to 75, and he didn't find out it was Sarah till he's 99. That's God for you.
Yeah, praise God.
That's God for you. But when he believed, he didn't consider the deadness of Sarah's womb, see?
Yeah.
He believed God. When God told him to go to a mountain and offer up Isaac, he headed for the mount.
That's right.
It looked like he was going to be killing the promised seed.
Yeah.
I'm sure that when Jesus told a nobleman, go, he went back home.
Amen.
Like his father Abraham did. Now, it's as, here's our text, says, as he was going down. It's on the way that he got this message. Just like as Abraham was on the way to Canaan, that's when he was directed where to go. He had to get out of Ur before we're good. You got to get out of Ur. See, you learn when you're on the way, in the highway of holiness. You're progressing on the road God has provided. See? That's when you learn. This is not normally taught. I don't know if it's because it's not known or why, but you're not going to get further revelation till you start out living by faith. And trusting in God, depending upon Him. It's in that process that you learn more. Mm-hmm. That's the same thing that happened here. You got to be in the straight and narrow. You have to be walking in the straight and narrow way before you're going to get any required information.
Yeah.
Before any confidence is ministered to your heart. It won't be on the couch. It's going to be in the way.
Amen.
While your journeys. It's a great kingdom secret. It's a great kingdom secret, believe me. The disciples, they wanted to know what Jesus said. They had to be going where he was going. They had to accompany him where he was going. That's where they picked up all the information. That's where they got it, when they were in the way. So you run the race set before you. And while you're running it, that's when these other benefits and answers and strengthening and all the things that come from heaven, they come to you while you're on running the race that leads to glory, while you're fighting a good fight of faith. Now, some people, they spend their lives murmuring and complaining. They never learn anything. If you know anybody like this, if you do, and we all do know people like this, just to give a kind of a holy analysis of them, and you'll find they never learn anything. Why? That's just a road you don't learn on. Turning, murmuring and complaining and griping turns the revelation spigot off. Why? Because that takes you off the road. We journey this road blessing God, amen, not murmuring. See, God gave us an example of Israel. They were a bunch of gripers, boy. They could have avoided a lot if they wouldn't have griped so much. And they complained about the kind of food they had. They complained about the environment they had to journey in. See, they just complained all the time. So they didn't receive anything. I'm pointing out here now what I'm going to be developing is that while you're walking by faith, while you're living in the Spirit, then's when you get things that you need to finish the journey and to build your confidence. That's when you get them. So he's on the way now. Jesus said, go your way. He's on his way. And his servants meet him. He's on the right road. They apparently knew where to hook up with him. His son had been healed, but that servants didn't know whether the nobleman knew or not. They wanted to bear the news to him, so they set out to tell him what had actually happened. They knew the nobleman had gone to ask of Jesus, so I can imagine they must have been pretty happy as they were journeying along, talking with one another. While they're journeying, while the nobleman's journeying, that's when this good news is going to come to him. Now, you remember when Jacob, he was on his way, the scripture says he was on his way. Genesis 32:1 says, the angels of God met him. Whoo, boy. Not an angel, the angels of God. Who's going to fear Esau when you see this band of angels? God sent Aaron into the wilderness, Exodus 4:27, to meet Moses. See, who was beginning to make his way back to Egypt. He sent someone to meet Moses to encourage him. When King Saul was anointed, the Lord, scripture says, the Lord gave him another heart. And while he was coming to a hill, a company of prophets met him. See, I'm showing you when you're in the right way, you'll get things from God. When Obadiah was in the way, behold, Elijah the prophet met him. There's a lot about this in Scripture. When the women went to the tomb, remember, and Jesus said, go tell, when they were on the way back, Jesus himself met them. See? So this is one of the great benefits of walking in the Spirit, walking in the light, running the race, living by faith, is the precious meetings along the way. It's not coincidence. And Paul was on his way to Rome as a prisoner. Some brethren heard he was coming, and they went out to meet him. He's on the way, see? Went out to meet him, strengthened him. Well, I couldn't begin to tell you how many such meetings I've had. Whereas on the way, sometimes I had a big load on my back. But there's some child of God met me along the way. See, this is Jesus administering the kingdom. This is what's happening. Jesus is administering the kingdom, but you got to be on the road. You have to be on the way. You have to have your faces set like a flint to the homeland. Then he'll send you helps. But if you won't, you'll just have to hack it along. That's the way it'll be. Sometimes I don't have the courage to tell some people this. Maybe I should. People are bold about it. Say, if you'd stop wandering off the road, you'd be getting something. Don't be telling me how people don't like you and nobody comes to you. You're off the road. What do you expect? Yes, Brother Jeremy.
I was thinking when you were talking, I thought, You know, some people don't go on the way because they're too busy complaining and murmuring about their situation to
exactly
get going.
Okay. So God doesn't send comforters to people like that. Well, they wouldn't know what to do with them if he did.
Given a thing, and I've heard people say, well, we're just like those Israelites. And
yeah.
No, we're not.
No.
In Christ Jesus, we have much more. We're not murmurers and complainers. We're doers.
Just in recent months and years, virtually all of you have met some new brethren that you didn't know before.
Yes.
See, this wasn't coincidence. This is what God does.
Amen.
For his people. Sometimes you have to go away to meet him, but it's worth it. Was it worth it? Was it worth it? Huh? Was it worth it if you drove a few hundred miles to meet a cluster of brethren? Were you satisfied that you did, or did you say that it wasn't worth it? I have been places it wasn't worth, you know. So this is a great thing to see right here. The nobleman will be met by his servants who are going to bear some good news to him. And here's the news they gave. He must have been bursting at the seams. Your son lives.
Yeah.
As the next verse indicates, this was not an instant healing. I got to spend a little time on this. But the dying process had been aborted.
Yeah.
See, the boy was in the dying process. When he came to Jesus, he was at the point of death. He was in the dying process, but that process was aborted.
Amen.
And he began to live. See, so it was a miraculous work, but it wasn't at all an instant. There's no more signs of dying.
Yeah.
I guess you look at this boy, you wouldn't conclude he's dying. He didn't look like he was dying because he wasn't dying. There's some people, I've known people when I saw them when they were dying. Spirits are dying. And then I saw them when they weren't dying. I could sure tell the difference. Haven't you been able to tell the difference? Things like this. Like Samson's hair. You remember they shaved off his hair? Those Philistines. See, Philistines are stupid. They should have kept him shaved. But see, Philistines are stupid. Scripture says, howbeit, the hair of his head began to grow again. I've seen people like that. I've said, watch out. Their hairs began to grow again. They're coming back. They're not in the death process anymore. I've seen that happen to people. It's a wonderful thing to see.
Again, I'm reminded of that song that we sang, God be with you.
Yes.
In their snipe, death threatening
wave.
Amen.
Amen.
Who knows how many times he's done that.
Amen.
That if Satan would have had his way, they'd have taken us out. He's taking us out. God doesn't tell us that. Probably keep us too busy seeing it. But he does care for his own. See, what had happened here, this nobleman, he asked and he received. He knocked and it was opened. He sought and he found. See, this was he did exactly what the prophet, psalmist, and the prophet said this would happen. They said, you'll find me when you seek me with your whole heart. They told the people, this is what will happen. The problem's not on the divine side, it's on the human side. And if you will seek him, you'll find him.
Praise God.
It took the nobleman a while to get to Jesus, but he got what he was seeking. You remember that this process is promised to the people of God. Going to Christ about somebody else. See? If any man, John, this is John above, he's talking about a saved man, you understand? If any man will see a brother sin, a sin that's not unto death, a sin unto death is that death comes because of the sin. Like with Judas or Ananias and Sapphira or Uzzah, you know, people, they died because they sinned. So if a person's sinning and he's still alive, he hasn't apparently sinned to sin unto death. He shall ask. Believer shall ask. And he, God, will give him life for them that sin not unto death. So God will quicken this person because you asked.
Amen.
That's what it says now. That's in the Bible. For the church. It's a wonderful promise.
Yes, amen.
There's sometimes when teaching, testimony, exhorting, rebuking, there comes a time when it's got to end. And you got to resort to this other method. And blessed is the person that knows when that time is. There's a time when you're wasting your time trying to talk them out of it. You're wasting your time. This nobleman knew what to do when all other resources ran out.
Yeah.
He found out where Jesus was, because Jesus was mobile. He was on the move all the time. So if you wanted to find Jesus, you just didn't go to point A and he was always there. You had to find out where he was.
Uh-huh.
There was people communication in those days. I don't doubt in the way he asked, where is Jesus? Well, he's over here. He's over here near Capernaum. He's over there. You can't even get, he's over here. So he knew when to seek Christ. I don't doubt that he tried everything that was available to them, but it didn't work. And so he went to Jesus and interceded for his son. His son was healed because his father asked Jesus to do it. You got someone in your family like that? Then don't be griping about it. Step up and go to the Savior about him.
Amen.
If you've been pleasing him, he'll listen to you.
Amen.
Technically, Jesus knew about this son. He didn't have to be like told about the son. But this is how God is working in the day of salvation. This is how God works. Things don't run on automatic pilot. It isn't God knows this is going to happen and he changes the circumstances. This isn't how salvation works. It's not how God works in this economy. Why not? Because in automatic mode, God doesn't receive the glory. If believers just didn't get sick ever, and there never was any sick among them or anything like this, pretty soon they quit associating that with God. So the kingdom's set up so you're like forced into this acknowledging that it's of God that these things happen.
That's why the Lord calls us beyond habit.
That's right. Amen.
Oh, yes. Amen.
Yeah.
Now this economy that we're in requires alertness.
Uh-huh.
You have to be alert and perceive and understand and be ready to praise, give God the glory. All right, so his servants meet him and say to him, "Thy son liveth." He said, "He's not dying anymore." Whenever the Holy Spirit provides details, it's not just fillers. If you're a writer, sometimes you have to kind of resort to a filler of some kind, you know. You got to fill up a paragraph, you got a couple of lines. You want to have something of substance, but some books, if you read them, there's a bunch of filler in it. It's like sausage, it's got a lot of meal in it and not much meat. You see, there's some writing like that. But that isn't the way it is with Holy Spirit. When he gives information, details, it's not just like fillers. These details contain some helpful insight that will help us evaluate, be good judges of things. Spiritual life is always characterized by thoughtfulness and focus and alertness. See, like children in the flesh, the children of God have to grow up in this. Children, they're not alert. They could walk right out in the middle of a road. Dog frothing at the mouth, they'll try and pet it, you know. They're not alert. See, they've got to grow up to where they are. The same way with the people of Christ. They've got to grow up into Christ in all things so they're alert. They see dangers coming. They see things that have to be addressed. They see things you got to take to Jesus. They know how to interpret good news that comes to them, see? But you have to be alert. Grow up to do this. And I find it in our day, it's difficult to get this kind of mindset because there's a lot of meaningless noise and distractions that kind of dull a person's perception. There's so much stuff you can't stand that's all around you that if you're not careful, you'll shut off some valuable part of your soul. Oh, yeah. There's some places that are particularly like this. It's just aggravating, aggravating environments. When you're running, you're just on the edge all the time, see? So what I'm saying is there's grace to do it, to become focused in that kind of environment.
Amen.
There's grace to become focused.
Amen.
So he inquired. He said, when did he begin to amend? It's interesting. Isn't that an interesting question? When did he begin to amend? When did he start getting better? He assumed that they understood, they would be able to identify this. So this isn't just curiosity. I wonder how that happened. He's in the process of correlating this report with what Jesus said. The report has got to match what Jesus said, see? And this is a process. So he asked for information that'll help him to coordinate what Jesus said with what actually happened. You might refer to this as a this is that perspective. You're looking for something Jesus said would happen. There it is. This.
Amen.
Now that does something for the heart. It does something for your heart when you see something happen that Jesus said would happen.
Amen.
All of a sudden this builds you up. This is the very real ministration to the human spirit. The human spirit is, in a sense, is very strong, and in another sense, is very frail.
Uh-huh.
It can get knocked down. It can be stood up, you know. And so he's looking for, when he came to Jesus, he was in a downward spiral. Come down, my son's dying. See, he was in a downward spiral. Now he's in the upward one. He doesn't want to go down again. So he inquires, when did he begin to recover? Now here, healing was gradual. See, now this isn't the way it always was. A process of recovery was set in motion. The dying process was stopped, and as process of recovery, he began to amend or get better. Or began to recover, started to get better, began to improve, see? There is a work of God that does this. The person begins to recover.
Yeah.
All of God's works is not like this, but some of them are. There was, you remember, a blind man that Jesus had to take out of the city of Bethsaida. It was a citadel of unbelief. He had to get him out of that environment. And the environment was such a stilted environment that he had to touch him two times before he could see. This is Jesus. Two times before he could see. When Jesus raised Jairus' daughter, first thing he told him was, give her something to eat. All right, so she wasn't raised up, filled up, and not hungry. She woke up hungry. But here now, we have a body that was at the point of death, and it begins to amend, or the hair begins to grow again. Among other things, This confirms to us that divine power cannot be contained by a stereotyped routine. You cannot take a routine that's been invented by men and invest it with divine power. This is impossible. God will not do this. He will not do this. What would be the point in doing this? He wouldn't get the glory for it. See? Process of recovery. Every miracle is precisely tailored. This was miraculous that he began to amend was miraculous. Because if Jesus hadn't intervened, that boy would have died. He was in the process of death. So in all aspects of the kingdom of God, there is divine wisdom and purpose. There's never form without power. God is never in form without power. People may do things the right way, huh? They may say things the right way, but if there's no power, it's not of God. And it's amazing what people can do just by sheer human discipline. It's amazing what they can do. But it doesn't touch the spirit of man at all.
Amen.
So the men respond, well, yesterday, about the seventh hour. That means they've been on the road for a day, right? Right? They've been on the road for a day. Mm-hmm. Yesterday. Now, some of the other versions read, yesterday at 1 p.m, the fever left him. The Holman Bible says, yesterday at 7 a.m. God's Word Bible says, yesterday evening at 7:00. The difference of these versions are because the 24-hour clock is Roman time. Hebrew time was 12 hours a day and 12 hours of night. And in the Bible, that's the time that it talks of. Jesus said, are there not 12 hours in the day? See, man, Roman time was either 24 hours in a day. That the day was a complete cycle of evening and night, and there's a sense in which the evening and the morning were the first day. I mean, there's a sense in which that's true, but it comprised of two different parts. And so this is a seventh hour, would have been seventh hour from the beginning, 6:00, so it'd be about 1 p.m. So he began to amend right after lunch. He began to amend. Right about the time midday began, it was noticeable. He began to live instead of die. That it was something you could see. Yes.
Yeah, it's a fever. That's what they were having problems with.
Yeah.
They couldn't get this fever to break.
That's right.
He knew he was burning up and he was dying. They done everything he could do.
Then all of a sudden,
to break a fever, and it was not working. So
yeah. All of a sudden, it broke.
Fever broke. See. That was a turning point.
Amen.
Amen.
But you notice they knew precisely when this happened.
Yeah.
They didn't say, oh, I can't remember exactly when it was. See, this is how people talk today. Yeah, it's just dismissed. I don't dismiss it.
Amen.
I don't trust people that can't remember well. I will not subject my soul to people that can't remember well.
Well, they knew he was going to ask Jesus.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Someone will say, what about your father? He got so he couldn't remember anything, but he never forgot the word of God.
Amen.
If you wanted to have an intelligent conversation with my father after he was in that condition, you had to talk about the scripture.
Amen.
You couldn't talk about politics or home life or stuff. You couldn't talk. He didn't even know when he ate last. But as soon as you talked about... See, the part of a man that's regenerated does not deteriorate.
Amen.
The spirit of a person in Christ never gets Alzheimer's.
Amen.
Doesn't happen. That's an affliction of the natural soul of man. But what's going on inside, don't assume that when a person's in a coma, or when they can't reason correctly, don't assume that deep down in their spirit they don't know more than you think they know.
Yeah.
You talk to people like that,
amen,
like they know.
Yeah.
I've probably said this more than I should say it, but when my mother was completely incapacitated for 5 years, couldn't talk, couldn't make motions, just lay there. When my father and I would talk about the things of God, he'd get on one side of the bed and I'd get on the other, and we'd talk back and forth over her. We could see her eyes move, and you could tell by her eyes, they kind of brighten up. Yeah, I've spoken to people who have been in comas, just leaned down and testified in their ear. Just did it. So these people knew when it happened. They were alert. They've been on the road for about an hour. I can only imagine what they've been talking about on the way there. And the father knew. Said, so the father knew. That's exactly when Jesus said, your son lives. He knew when Jesus said that. The time he said it. I'm talking about being alert. Alert to the working of the Lord. If you're not an alert type person, and our society produces non-alert people, you can overcome that, but it's like a robber. If you're not alert, it like takes from you a lot of wonderful things that you'd know otherwise. Yeah. You say, oh, this is that. Oh, this is what God said. See, you've got this holy recollection. Because a man who's taught in the kingdom of God takes out of his bag things new and things old. He reaches in there. The father knew that it was the seventh hour, the exact time Jesus spoke. See, some people, they can remember when they were physically born. Well, that's based on testimony, of course. But they can't remember when the day dawned and the day star rose in their heart. And the kind of Christianity that's afoot today, it doesn't encourage people to remember when did it all come together for you. I got to remember when it did me. I got to remember when it all came together. These are remembrances that will bless you all through your whole life. There's other things when you remember them, they cast you down. There's things like that. He remembered. He was alert. His trouble didn't wash away his alertness. He was alert. When did you begin to grow up into Christ in all things? You are no more a child tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. When did that happen? It's good to ask yourself, when did this happen? You'd be surprised how much you know about that. Buried in the back of recesses of your heart, you have more information on that than you think, see? And it'll bless your heart to remember it. Now here's an interesting thing. He remembered. That's exactly when Jesus said, thy son liveth, and himself believed. That's the second time now it said this man believed. When the Lord first spoke to him, said, thy son liveth, he said, and the man believed the word of Jesus, had spoken unto him, and he went his way. So that's the first time he believed. Here's the second time he believed. The first reference relates to him believing what Jesus said, right? That he believed the word. The second refers to him believing on Christ himself. That's different. It's not at variance with the other, but it's going further and deeper. This is another example of from faith to faith. See, it's another example of that. It has to begin by believing what Jesus said.
Yeah.
But that's got to lead to an unfettered trust.
Amen.
In and dependence on Christ.
Amen. Actually, his faith is growing.
That's exactly right.
That's testimony.
That's exactly right.
Continue to confirm. confirm itself and continue to grow.
It increased. Yeah. That's exactly right. I sorrow for people that aren't submitted to things that make for an increase of faith. They're always dealing with hearing baby stuff. Baby food, all the time, baby food, baby food, baby food. And faith doesn't grow on spiritual baby food. See? That's not the way it grows. Yes, Sister Maddie.
An example of how the Lord is able to help our unbelief.
That's right.
When our
Amen.
Faith grows, then we're able to believe on another level.
Amen. You see, now here it was a crisis that brought this man to Jesus, but it was not a crisis that kept him with Jesus. There are people, may the Lord open their eyes, that only come to Jesus in a crisis. Faith doesn't grow like that. Once you've been aided in a crisis, then you've got to learn from that to trust him and lean not to your own understanding. From faith to faith, Romans 1:17. Other versions read, from faith unto faith, it begins and ends with faith, depending on faith and tending to produce faith, the way of faith that leads to greater faith. See this? But if you think of faith as a doctrinal statement, this is taught. I was taught this. Contend for the faith. That's a doctrinal statement. See, you'll never experience this.
Right. Brother Aaron was trying to
comment. Oh, Brother Aaron, sorry.
Yeah, Philippians chapter 3, Paul opened up his heart when he talked about what made him tick, basically, in the excellency of the knowledge, pressing forward towards the prize, throwing all the rubbish off. And then he said it, and if anybody thinks differently than this, God will teach you better.
That's right.
Basically,
yeah, that's right.
So he's saying this is the way God works in people, is this growing progression of reaching forward and going forward and making progress. And then, so there's an expectation. Paul wasn't just a taskmaster.
No.
You have to live this way. Is it? This is the way that, like the mode of the kingdom. So
Amen.
If you're in the kingdom, then this is what's happening. And if you're drawing back, then it's not. But then he also let us in on a little more insight about the whole thing. He said, and whatever you have attained, keep that.
That's right.
Live by the same rule and mind the same thing. And I've thought about that text several times tonight
Amen.
And this man, the father that asked, he actually lived this way. He approached Christ in this way where what he had, he kept. He didn't ever lose what he added to it, but he never did lose anything.
Amen.
That he had.
That's good. Any man be otherwise, God-minded, God will reveal this to him. So you stay on the road. If you stay on the road, Jesus is on the road too. You'll hear a voice behind you. Isaiah said, you'll hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way. Turn off here. Well, he believed in his whole house. Another version says his whole household. Now, I understand in Scripture that household involves more than family in those days. It included servants. You have an example of it in Abraham. His servants were part of his house or household. Everyone in that house, whether it was his wife or his children or servants, whoever was in that house believed. Now, there's a number of household conversions mentioned in Scripture, whole houses converted. Cornelius, his whole household. Lydia, she believed her whole household. The Philippian jailer, his whole household. Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, his whole household. Stephanus, him and his house were the first fruits of the region of Achaia. We also read of believers by house. The house of Judas, he was a believer. That was the house that God sent Ananias to this man's house to direct him to Saul. There's the house of Simon the Tanner. Peter stayed there. There's the house of Mary, the mother of John, where they held prayer meeting, remember, when Peter was released from prison by an angel. There's the house of Lydia, house of Jason, house of Philip, the house of Chloe, house of Stephanus, the house of Onesiphorus. Is Aristobulus' household and the household of Narcissus. See, whole houses. What? It's blessed to think about this. Whole houses that believed. And we live in a kind of a fragmented society where houses are divided. Not all living for the same reason, not all on the same page. But you can refer to these instances in Scripture. You can refer to them and ask the Lord to help you have that kind of house, the whole house. Believe. It also tells you that someone was in charge of that house. Abraham's house wasn't run by a democratic rule, but he led his house to the whole house. He led his household so that Ishmael stood out like being different. So take heart, if you're the head of your household, take heart, seek this kind of grace. Concept of a household has all but disappeared in our society. See, if you have a tight-knit family, you're unusual probably on your block. This isn't common, and our society doesn't make for this kind of development, for this kind of thing. The church must present this concept to the world. The church is it's a household. It's a household of faith. It's a household of God. See, and so it must present this concept of the whole house is in. Now, brethren, a lot of churches don't present this concept. Even the world can tell. The whole house isn't in. But that's one of the stewardships that we have as the people of God, is to introduce the idea of an entire household. Amen. Believing in Christ. Amen. And then Luke says, now this is the second miracle. Now this is just, it's not the second miracle Jesus wrought. It was the second miracle he wrought since he came out of Judea into Galilee. He'd worked miracles before this. John 2:23, which is before this, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. Well, that's considerable before our text here. Also, prior to this incident, the woman of Samaria, Nicodemus came to Jesus and said, "Don't make her do these miracles." He said, "Jesus had done a lot of miracles, but these are miracles he did when he left Judea to go into Galilee." Now, in Galilee, the cities where he preached were mostly dominated by unbelief. This is a sad thing. They were in Galilee. Bethsaida, Chorazin, Capernaum. They were all in Galilee, not in Judea. And the scripture says that they were the cities where he did most of his mighty works. And they all were citadels of unbelief. So you know, why did Jesus do that? Jesus was demonstrating that these people were unrecoverable. There are some people that are unrecoverable. Now, we don't know. I'm quick to say we don't know who these people are, and we shouldn't try and figure out who they are, but God does. And God sends his son to Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum, and he just flooded the area with mighty works, and it didn't move the people. That shows what they really were. They were paths on which the seed would not grow. That's why he did this. There were other people. He went up into a heathen territory near Tyre and Sidon, journeyed up there and found a woman, Syrophoenician woman, who didn't blend with that society up there. Huh? He went up there and he rescued her. Went over near where a Gadarene demoniac was. Went over there and rescued a person. But when Jesus works where he's not appreciated, it doesn't mean he wasn't powerful enough. It means that they weren't ready. They weren't the kind of people that can be moved. There are some people a son of God can't move. And you've got to be able to pick up on whether you're wasting your time or it's profitable. I've known people that were missionaries that labored for 20, 30 years and only had two converts. Now, when I was younger, I thought, well, at least they had two, you know. But this isn't the way holy men thought. Paul didn't stay in Athens, did he? He left Athens. Because most of the people weren't receptive at all. Anyway, this is why, to me, Jesus did this. Now, he made a statement about these cities. He told Capernaum, if the mighty works which had been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day. Is that a statement or is that a statement? Huh? If Sodom had seen what you have seen, they wouldn't have been destroyed. Oh, what? That is some statement. Then to Chorazin and Bethsaida, he said this. If the mighty works which had been done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. See, these were cities that were desolated, accursed and desolated. Just rocks were left there. He said they would have repented. If the works that I did in you were done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented. What a word. So that's why Jesus wrought those works there, to show that that was the case. Demonstrated what they really were. Now, the people of our day need to hear how Jesus feels about people that ignore him. He is not indifferent to this. Jesus is not indifferent to being ignored or to forgetting what he said or to not striving to please him. He's not indifferent to this. Yet, look, some people think he's indifferent to it, but he's not. He's not indifferent to it. He will work in such a way as angelic hosts will see it, and maybe some on earth will see it, that these people are so bad, they have descended to such depths that the Son of God could work mighty works before them, and they're just as calloused and hard as a rock. It doesn't affect them. Now, need I say, at all cost, don't be in that category. If you, and sometimes if you're alert, you'll feel a kind of an indifferent attitude trying to make inroads in your heart. You got to kill that thing.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because you can get to the point where the mighty Son of God will not work a favorable effect upon you. So when you feel this, it's an encroachment. Satan is trying to get his foot in the door. It always begins by, well, that's not all that important. You know, God loves you just like you are. Yeah. And it disarms a person. I think I'll close there, but there's a lot in that text. Any of you have something you'd like to say, Brother Judah?
This point that himself believed and his whole house shows the far-reaching effects of what Jesus does.
That's right.
I read an account today of a brother being martyred overseas by being burned at the stake, and an onlooker, a fellow Christian, someone who knew the man being killed, got the attention of the persecutors and told them, if you want to keep burning, you'd best do it in a cellar, because the smoke of his burning has opened the eyes of many.
Yeah.
Jesus was in him.
That's right.
And the work of Jesus got out through him, because it was really Jesus that was doing the work. So when Jesus does the working, you can count on the fact that it will be heard about, and it will spread.
That's right.
Because Jesus doesn't stay in one area. He keeps going.
Yes, Sister Melissa.
This alertness that you talked about is tied to fellowship with Christ.
Yep.
Closer your fellowship, the more you draw near to him, he draws near to you. And you can have constant fellowship with Christ every day, all day
yes,
long,
amen.
At night. I mean, when you wake up, you can maintain this fellowship. They didn't have this back then, but we have it now. But the Spirit ministers to us in such a way that sometimes there's these things that you know, like this man knew.
That's right. Amen.
And then maybe they're revealed a little ways later, but sometimes it's a while. And sometimes they're private things that may not be displayed until we all come together,
yeah. Amen.
You know, as saints. But then you had talked about the Lord not doing things the same way all the time because he wouldn't get the glory. But the reason for this is he gets glory as our faith has increased. And so the more our faith is increased, it glorifies God.
Yeah.
And then when we all get to heaven together, there's going to be a large culmination of glory.
Yeah. Amen.
Because there's going to be a lot of things that seem that's not even able to be seen here.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Sister Bailey.
I was thankful tonight concerning this man and his whole house, concerning them believing. And just thinking about reading through these different accounts of households being saved and coming to the Lord gives you more assurance and strengthens your faith, because there are so many houses even in our world today that are divided or there none of them are believing. But it gives you confidence knowing that God did this in the past, and so he can do it again.
That's right.
And so when you see households and you're praying, don't continue to labor. You can read over these accounts, and they build your faith up and give you confidence
yes.
in the Lord.
Amen. That household of Stephanus, he was the first fruits of a region of Achaia. That household was. First ones that converted there. Anyone else tonight? Yes, Brother Ricky.
There's always a liability when you're facing some kind of trial to become engrossed and absorbed in the trial.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
Where the main thing, your affection doesn't seem to be able to reach beyond the desire to see this thing resolved. And this man is an exhortation to all of us, because if he had been that way, there would have been no further inquiry after he had heard that his son was blind.
Yeah.
But there was a further inquiry, which tells you, coming to Christ, in the midst of that, it piqued his interest in Christ, so that there was something beyond just his son being
Amen.
Well. And that is the good effect that a miracle will have on someone who is walking by faith.
Yes. Amen. Yes, please.
Yeah, I like this household thing that you brought up. You know, we also have more examples of, like, Noah and his household
That's
was
right.
saved, and Rahab
Rahab
and her
household,
household was
That's
saved,
right.
and Lot.
Yes,
he said, any in your household, his sons weren't saved. They thought he was joking. They lacked that seriousness that you were talking about. They didn't fully assess the gravity of their situation.
They didn't think a city could be destroyed. Yes, it's Sasha.
Whenever somebody has faith and they believe what Jesus said he will do, they're anticipating that work to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what this man, when he met his servant on the road, he was anticipating the report of Christ working as he said he had worked.
Yes, amen. Amen. Mm-hmm.
There's a outside view of the scriptures, just viewing it as a document or, you know, historical record that looks for patterns and this kind of thing, studies it like it's just strictly written by men.
Mm-hmm.
There's an inside view of Scripture that those who are reconciled to God actually have the author of Scripture dwelling in them.
Amen.
So that's what I mean by inside view.
Amen.
And so then we see that there's dimensions to the Scripture. There's heights and depth and length and breadth. And so we see the nature of faith being lived out in this man. And we see the divine nature being lived out in Jesus. And the nature of spiritual life being lived out in these people. And I'm thankful for that. But it's,
amen.
It's not just a record of what happened that we should say, take away from this text, that we should pray to. Although that's true. But there's so much more in the text to be seen.
Amen. I think you'll find that as you go and grow in Christ, you'll be able to identify with more and more texts of Scripture, whether it's a record of someone else who believed or a promise or whatever. You'll connect with more of Scripture. It'll be what they call relevant. Yes, Brother Abe.
I just wanted to say that I enjoyed your phrase when you said there is grace to be focused. You know, all of us, many of us can remember times when we wanted to be more focused. I just wanted to say it's a good time to be thankful for the grace to be focused and to be merciful and help others be focused.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
That's a great contribution.
Yeah.
For somebody. To say, be able to say, look.
Somewhat what Jesus was exhorting this man to do, to be focused when he said, go your way. Like, go for the thing you came for. Don't give up what you came for.
Remember, Jesus told that gathering to money, go and tell what great things the Lord has done to you. He was providing a focus. He was the focus of attention when he was a madman, see? Yeah. It's a different focus now. All right, we're ready for Sister Barb.